So we have our guests. I'm going to go
talk about what we just played, and I'm going to bring you on.
Technical.
Dope. I love it.
Cool. And then what else?
So I came in on the
we introduced ourselves to De La Way. So I am IB. So I am your name, IB, doing something.
I love it.
Awesome. Love it. Cool.
My favorite album, Blow My State.
Basically,
oh, word? Yo. Album of, you know they have a new album? We'll talk about this on.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Right. I see we're going to be talking about all type of random stuff. All right, cool. Let me go through these joints.
Really dope.
Oh, man.
Hey.
Yo.
All right, so I'll just kind of talk into our special guests, and yeah. All right, real quick, let's talk about what we just played. Let's see here. All right, instrumental in the background, this crazy joint by the Immortals, featuring John Robinson and Internal Quest, called Pass It Off. Big shouts to Duplicuts and Elder Sensei. They make up the Immortals project. All right, let's see. Before that, we had QNC with Demo. That joint is crazy.
Yes, that's what I need. I need that.
Okay.
All right. I need that.
Before that, we had Ghostface, Killah, Adrian, Younge featuring Scarub with a track called Rise Up.
Yep, yep.
Before that, we had, where the hell did it go? Oh, big shout to King Magnetic, produced by DJ Premier, called Status. Before that, we had Method Man, Redman, Hanz On, Streetlife with Straight Gutta. And we saw some homegrown old Orlando hip hop, AMiAM, Warm Welcome, produced by Rude 100. All right.
Word
up. So now, hold on, let me bring this down, bring that up so that we can hear him. All right, folks. Like I said at the top of the hour, beginning of the show, we have a really dope interview coming up.
You know yes, what I'm saying? We do.
Like, it's in the vein of the stuff we do because it's dope.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But it's different because there's so much more around it.
Right.
You know what I mean? Right? You guys would agree because you heard the album.
Definitely
right.
Would agree.
And we play all type of stuff on the show, but it's like a whole new perspective that I don't think we've ever played. We played like some producers, but we never had MCs talk about where they came from that side. You know what I'm saying? I know I'm being mad vague.
Right, but definitely, it's definitely one of those things where you're going to, it garners a greater appreciation.
Right? Because it's almost that you know it's there, but then you don't see it all the time, so it's almost like it's not there.
Yeah, you're definitely going to, listening to this project is you're going to have a greater understanding and be more appreciative, more empathetic towards.
Exactly. But that's all that to say, we have Gyasi Ross on the show. Hey, what's going on, fam?
All right.
Peace, greetings. Nice to be here, bro. I'm broadcasting live from Sitka, Alaska, home of the Clinkat people, the Home Skillet Fest Music Festival. It's cold up here, and it's still early. It's only 1:30 here.
Nice. And you know, we actually have a listener in Alaska also. His name is Chris.
Okay, peace, Chris.
Where is he? I think he's in Anchorage, I think it was.
Yeah.
Think so. Yeah, so how far are you from Anchorage?
Bro, I have no freaking clue.
Wow. I
came up here for the music festival, but you know, on a real level, I also need to get familiar. My son, he's a member of the Clinkat tribe, which is up here. And so it's important to understand, you know, this is where his ancestry comes from. You know, you gotta give thanks. He's a dope little kid.
Nice. Now speaking of ancestry. Let's take it back. I want to know, I'm saying your name right, Gyasi Ross?
Gyasi. The Y Gyasi. Is kind of silent, yeah.
Okay, Gyasi Ross. Thank you for correcting me. I'm saying, like, I would have just messed it all up. But tell me, what's your earliest hip-hop memory?
My earliest hip-hop memory, I actually wrote something about this. You know, first and foremost, I am Gyasi Ross. I be a storyteller, you know, indigenous style.
Nice.
And so, I remember when I was a little kid, I grew up on the Blackfeet Indian Reservation in Browning, Montana. And it's a very rural place. There's only 1 million people in all the state of Montana. And hip hop was the last thing that people were thinking about. But I have a cousin, his name is Leland Bear Medicine. And Leland Bear Medicine is one of those just fly dudes. Like, he's just fly at all times.
Name sounds dope. I mean, just.
Yeah, no, it's poetic. You know, he could draw. He was, you know, he was. And so we're in the country. Dirt roads. I didn't even have running water. You know what I'm saying? My family, I grew up without running water, but my cousin Leland Bear Medicine got a hold of I was a little kid. I was probably like 7 years old. Beat Street, and you know, it was like when in the movie The Gods Must Be Crazy when the bottle fell out of heaven, you know, and they didn't know what to do with it. Like Beat Street fell out of heaven, and we were like all of a sudden, you know, we have breaking crews and we're battling other people. We have no cultural context whatsoever, but we just understood that it was a powerful force.
Oh, that's dope. So like just on the reservation, you guys just breaking.
Nah, man, we was on dusty ass roads, you know, doing suicide flips and trying to get our flares and yeah, man, you know, kicking up dust literally, you know, and we had once again no cultural context, but we understood it was a powerful force, and we also understood that it came from a position of desperation. It was poor people making something out of nothing, and that was a narrative that we could very closely relate to.
Right. Nice. Word up.
Well, I mean, yeah, that piece that you did for Gawker, the title on that was amazing, by the way. Breakdancing
yeah.
with Wolves.
Breakdancing
with
Wolves,
yeah. But yeah, I, when I was reading through that piece, you know, it reminded me that there's a native that goes by the name of DJ Element. And he's actually one of the bigger, B-boy DJs out, you know, in the world, you know, touring the world. And just, you know, the correlation that you put, you know, between, you know, life on the reservation and absorbing hip hop and then showing it, you know, that it's not just a culture that embraces, you know, blacks and Latinos at that time, but it there's something that speaks to the poor and the disenfranchised, which I really enjoyed that in the piece.
Thank you very much. Yeah, you know, that's something that's really important, and that's not to take anything away from the architects. We understand absolutely where it comes from. It's a black art form, you know, following in a long line of other black art forms, jazz, rock and roll. And certainly there's people that, you know, co-opt it with malicious and nefarious intentions. Mm-hmm. But, you know, for us, it came from a cultural standpoint of, once again, that desperation, isolation, feeling isolated within a place, you know, that you have evidently some kinship to. So in the projects, you understand that you don't own this. And so, mm-hmm. but you feel that sense of desperation, Beat Street breakdown, right? Like, I gotta fight for every piece that I got. And that's certainly amongst many of our reservations, definitely mine, where we have 75% unemployment, where we commit suicide at 3 times national average, that level of desperation spoke to me, and it spoke to a whole bunch of other folks as well.
Yeah, work. I mean, I think that is what, that's why hip hop is like a culture and not just a musical form.
Right.
At least to me, because it speaks to a mass of people. Mm-hmm. It's not necessarily just there to get you to dance or do something. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Especially earlier.
Yeah.
So because like I said, I have no concept of living on the reservation. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Now, like, could you explain, like, because I hate when I ask people, what was it like growing up on whatever? Because you know, you don't know other way. You're like, I don't know, I did it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, but how is it like cordon off? Cordon off sounds really bad, but I mean, it's a kind of a messed up situation anyway. How like the division lines, how does that work? Like, how do you know when you're on and off the reservation? Is it something physical or is it just a sign? You know what I'm saying? Am I getting?
No, it's a fair question. And, you know, it is a weird question because for you, it's just existence, right? It's just breathing. Like, I can't explain how to breathe. It's just who I am.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I went to school in New York City. Mm. And the reason why I went to New York school in New York City was because it was important for me to go to the cradle of hip hop, to go to the place where hip hop was invented. And so, you know, and when I was there, I became the default spokesperson for all things Native, you know, and I didn't necessarily want that title, but it's true. I was at a school. I went to Columbia and there was two Native people at the whole school. And so every time a question about Native anything, you know, somebody would ask about Indian summer. And it, like, everybody in the classroom would turn around and look at me. Somebody ask about Jeep Cherokee. Everybody look at me, you know, it's just anything. And so, I understand the question, and it's a fair question. The truth is, bro, that it depends largely on which reservation. Because there's 565 tribes federally recognized. That means that have a special relationship with the federal government. There's 565 of those. And it's substantially different from tribe to tribe. So, for example, the tribe where I was born and where I am a rep member of, the Blackfeet tribe, we're one of the tribes that it is literally like going into a different country, because it's the space is vast. It's almost 2 million acres of land, and we have our own set of laws that are, you know, autonomous and separate from the United States, separate from the state of Montana. You go there, and demographically, it's about 97% Native. So you go there and like, oh, damn, I'm in an Indian place. I'm in a place that's completely different. Culturally, you see in that particular reservation, you see the marks of poverty. You know, most of the housing, because the housing is held in trust status. It's not owned by individuals. It's owned by the tribe, which is ultimately by the United States Department of Interior. So as a result of that, there's no property taxes. And so what that means, the effect of that is 99% of the houses there are literally housing projects. And so because you don't have property taxes. And so there's so that has an effect on the schools, right? Because schools are ultimately reflected by the property taxes. And so it's completely separate than the experience at 99% of the rest of the United States. Whereas if you go someplace else to the Suquamish Reservation, where I currently live, it's right across the water from Seattle, and my family's also from there, it's really close to an urban area, which the Blackfeet Reservation isn't. It's much smaller. There's only about 1,000, there's only about 1,000 tribal members there. The tribe is about, on the reservation, it's about 60% non-native. So you don't have that same immersive experience of going someplace and feeling like you're in a different country, but there's still those cultural mores that are separate. Mm-hmm. And there's still that separate set of laws. So it varies widely. I spend a lot of time on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, where it gets a lot of attention because people like to use it. You know, a lot of liberals and politicians like to use it as the poster child of poverty within Indian country. And it absolutely has a lot of those issues, and it has those difficulties with unemployment, with the socioeconomic health indicators. But it also, these places are the most beautiful places in the world. I mean, and I mean that honestly, and how that's not a statement, a rah-rah statement, like a cheerleader statement. It's reflected by the fact that there's literally millions of tourists that go to these places because they want to see these places that have largely been untapped and haven't been, you know, like there's places within our territories where the soil is literally some of the richest soil in the world because it's never been tilled. It's never been turned over. So it has micronutrients and shit like, excuse my language, it has, you know, stuff from literally tens of thousands of years. And it has ancestors in there. It has powerful stuff in there. It's never been tilled. That's an amazing statement in 2015.
Damn, that yeah, because that's why I wanted to kind of get it across, because just as far as, you know, like African-Americans, like projects, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's kind of like, that's the thing. I don't know if it's something similar to that. Whereas it's like, you have this space here, do what you do with it. You know what I'm saying? And it's kind of like putting it off. So I'll just, that was just, because those are the type of things that birth hip hop.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like those are the conditions. Cause anywhere else, I don't think that would happen. And that's why it's such a cultural force. Cause people of all areas have that same, like that same kind of background, you know what I'm saying? Those conditions.
Well, right. There's a couple points I want to, you know, speak with you about. You know, thank you for explaining that regarding, you know, the taxes, you know, not or being exempt from paying property taxes, what have you. Because there are certain interludes and certain references that you make in the album that talks about people that aren't exactly thrilled about, you know, natives. There's interludes in there, and for you to make, you know, to make that point and clarify that, just completely shows that, you know, the people that are making those statements are 100% ignorant of what's really going on, and that speaks volumes.
And speaking of the album, I wanted to play a track off of there that kind of, it, like I said, your album is mad descriptive. Like I can see, you know, like it's almost like you're there, mm-hmm. like the border town joint. Like I'm like one of your homeboys. Like we're going into the shop together.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I wanna play that joint. And okay, now Gyasi, right? Did I say that right?
Gyasi.
Gyasi. Damn it.
Yeah.
Gyasi.
All right. Hey, all bro, right. can I make one point real quick? Cause you hit on something really, really deep.
Please.
Okay, real quick. You know, regarding the land, there's to bring it back, you know, a hip hop perspective. One of the deepest songs in hip hop lexicon and the discography to me is the song that came out when I was in, I think, freshman in high school, called Tennessee.
Yes.
And that song is exactly about that, about touching those elders, touching, because, you know, black folks within this country, it's funny how the word black has become synonymous with urban. When, in fact, every single black person in this country comes from a rural background. Every single one. And yep. The time spent within urban settings is very, very new. So that's what that song Tennessee was really, really touching on. And I think that, you know, regarding finding that centering spiritually for black folks, for anybody, has a lot to do with finding their place within the real estate, within the soil of where their folks actually come from. No, you don't come from Marcus Garvey projects in Manhattan. You come from South Carolina. And, you know, before that, obviously, you come from the Geechee Islands. Before that, you come from Africa. And so I think those are, you know, there is that correlation. It's not, you know, there's definitely a position of privilege that I can say I come from these places, but we all have that at some point. And I think it's important to acknowledge that and hopefully at some point actually connect with that.
Word. All right. Word. I mean, especially, like I said, with your album. Now, I'm going to butcher the name, but let me try. Is Kusik?
It's pretty close. It's pretty close. That's not bad. Iskutsik. Iskutsik, yes. It means before the concrete was here.
Nice. That's dope. And that's pretty much like what you were talking about. All right. So let's get into the first, like one of the joints I want to get off onto the show.
Thank you.
Now it's Border Town. It's like a real quick joint, but I feel like it pretty much sums up like your youth. Would you agree? Kind of like as far as interaction with the people on outside the reservation?
Yeah. I mean, it made you. And, you know, when I see all the stuff right now about, police officers and stuff like that, you know, for us, anybody, you know, a person of color, especially, you know, a lot of men of color, we understand that's been happening for a long time and it starts at a young age. And that's kind of what that song was about, just the genesis of where that, whether it be apprehension, whether it be trepidation, whether it be fear or anger, like that was the manifestation for me for a long time was anger. And that's where it starts from, these really, really small, innocuous stories that's like, nah, but that stays with you for a while.
Yeah, word up. Because especially as a child, and you don't understand where this like hate is coming from.
No clue.
You know what I'm saying? All right, so let's get into it. This is Border Town off of Iskutsik.
Iskutsik. Yes, sir.
Before Here Was Here, out now. You can get it at Gyasi, GYASI-ROSS.com. Right? We're good?
You can get it there. You can get it at Target. You can get it at Best Buy. You can get it at Amazon, iTunes. It's available every place. Shout to K Records. Shout to Cabin Games Records for setting that up, you know, getting the distribution situated. And they made it so that it's available every place.
That's dope. So now give me a random fact about Border Town. Just like a Jeopardy style joint. Like when you become big and huge, you're a Jeopardy question. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Give me something so that when I'm on there, I can get it right.
The Border Town is based on a true story. Great Falls, Montana. We used to go there Christmas shopping. And, you know, I've been chased out of many a store. I was big for my age. And so they always thought I, you know, I'm 6'5" now. And so, I was big for my age. And so I used to get, you know, they treated me like a grown man. They thought I was in there loitering or something like that, which is still not an excuse for that behavior. But that's where it originated from, was a small town called Great Falls, Montana.
All right, word up. Nice. All right, so we're going to get into it. Thank you guys for tuning in. It's our show. We'll be right back. And behind the scenes, while this is playing for the people on air, while the video is recording, I want to talk about the voicemails in the album that kind of go through it. If you could just kind of tell me about, because are those real voicemails? Like,
100% real.
That is so horrible.
That's crazy.
That is ignorance. Yeah. All right, cool. So we're going to talk about the story behind that while people listen to Border Town right now. We got Gyasi Ross.
There you go.
And Iskutsik. Ah, damn it. Iskutsik.
There you go. You got it.
Nice. All right, word up. Yeah. All right, so this is Border Town. Thank you guys for tuning in. It's our show. We're going to come back and talk about more, because he does, like he said,
we'll get into it.
Yeah, he like to other people, he like represents the Native American experience. We're gonna play the drums.
Let's get into that.
Thank you guys for tuning in to our show. We'll be right back. Y'all be easy and peace.
Peace.
Now, you guys may not be able to hear him, so that's gonna be a problem.
No, it's cool.
But let's get to this. It's only like a minute long.
All right. Loaded. $3 in my pocket.
Now, let me move this around.
With the town to get school closed.
So, yeah, so tell me about the interludes, like the voicemails. Like, where did that come from?
You know, I represent, I'm a lawyer by trade.
Yeah, I want to talk into that too.
And so I just collected, you know, stuff like people would come to me that I represent, largely Native American owned companies. And I would just collect stuff like, you know, racist emails, racist phone calls, and stuff like that. And this is real. There's no interpretation on it whatsoever. No editorializing. I just played it.
For me,
let it speak for itself.
But sir, I'm only 10.
That's
shut up, you little punk. I'll call
and to think that, and how old is it? Because I mean, like, how old was that? Last year.
It was from last year. Yeah, it was longer too. It was longer too. It was hilarious because I think she was, you know, she was pretty lit. It sounded like, and you know, it was just, it was fun to. I felt like calling her back and having a conversation recording that, but I thought that there might be some privacy issues. But, you know, she was open with her feelings.
Yeah, but I mean, but some things you just need to shut the hell up about. I mean, some people are just way too open. I don't understand.
Yeah, you know, it's with Native people, it's funny because, I was having like this, I'm not too much into
money. My first time.
Social media really engaging. Like I'll talk to people. I'll give, you know, like, hey, what's up, stuff like that. But I don't really argue. But there was this lady that took offense because I posted a statistic that said empirically, this is from the Center of Disease Control and Department of Justice, said that Native Americans get killed at a higher rate by police officers than any other ethnicity in the country.
Damn.
And she took that as like I was attacking the Black Lives Matter thing. This is a sister that was saying this. You know, she took it as that. And I was like, and then she started, you know, started telling me, well, you know, she started giving me these rationales for why Native people, like, you know, well, it's because it's such a small population size. And I said, well, explaining away stuff like that is kind of the point, that you feel perfectly at liberty to explain away things that happen to us without even listening to us why it happens.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
You occupy that space. And it feels like people feel very comfortable doing that with Native people.
Yeah, because it's almost at least here, it's not every, you know what I'm saying? It's not like everywhere. Like I don't see many Native Americans. You know what I'm saying? Like here in Florida. That's the thing. I think a lot of people are just ignorant to it. It's almost like I don't know.
You know what I mean? Can I give you a quick story that
please,
kind
go
of
right ahead.
I was riding on the train in New York. I went to school in New York. I was riding the train, and I had my hair in braids. I got long braids, and there was this dude, this older white gentleman that was sitting across on the train from me, and he was there with presumably his wife, some woman, and we're riding the train. He's staring at me, and like I'm not unfamiliar with that. Like I wear dangly earrings and I wear, you know, my hair in braids, so I understand. I'm not offended by or anything like that. He's just staring at me, and then so. Like I nod off a couple times. I wake up and he's still staring at me, and he got this grin on his face. And I'm like, "Hey, man, what's up?" He's like, "Nothing. I was just looking at you." I like, "Yeah, I noticed." And he said, "Are you Native American?" I said, "Yeah. What do you think I am?" He said, "Well, I thought you were Native American." He said, "But Native Americans can't grow beards, and you have a beard."
Wow.
Yeah. And I said, Oh, I didn't know that.
So I'm just gonna go home right now and shave this off.
Right, yeah, well, I'm doing this all wrong. So yeah, I mean, people feel really, really comfortable occupying that space where we're supposed to have a level of agency just like any other human being. Right. But, you know, for some reason, like because of, I don't know if it's because of imagery that's been put out or because of this thought that, you know, we're gone or I don't know. But for some reason, people that otherwise, even, you know, once again, the sister that was brilliant and was really, really an advocate for the Black Lives, they feel like occupying that space, like they feel comfortable speaking for us in ways that for me dehumanizes us. But it's in a way that they wouldn't do for anybody else. And I don't know exactly what the psychology is behind that.
Yeah, because it's almost like you can't speak up for yourself.
Yeah,
you know right. What I'm saying? Like, you're not powerful. Like you have, like, you're unable to do it.
Exactly. You know what I mean? Yeah.
So, okay, that's, yeah. All right, so now you mentioned you went to, when did you leave Montana?
I left Montana to move to the Suquamish Reservation when I was in high school.
Okay, and then from there you went to New York.
There I went a whole bunch. I was on the Indian plan for education, man. I went to 6 different colleges.
explain that to me. What was that?
I was just, you know, combination of pursuing hoop dreams, combination of being really, really broke. You know, there's a misconception that Native people go to college for free, and I'm still waiting for that check. You know, it didn't happen for me. You know, yeah, it's like Black folks waiting for the O.J. Simpson check, right? Like, we won. What did we win?
even before that, the 40 acres and a mule. What was that at?
Nice, right? That'd be a nice crib. No, but yeah, and then from there, after I graduated, I'm going to New York, and I moved there, and I was working with music for a little while, and then thereafter I ended up going to law school there, and just, you know, really trying to venture into New York life and hip hop from the point of Genesis, the Garden of Eden. You know, you have to check it out at some point.
Exactly, you made that pilgrimage.
That's exactly what it was. It was that special to me.
Now, what year about is this when you went to New York?
99.
Oh, ooh, 99. So that was a good time.
Yeah.
So
that was Rockus. That was when Rockus was killing it. You know, like for hip hop heads, it was a special time.
So now, what were some of the things that you were getting to while you were out there? Like, did you go into any like the Lyricist Lounge or open mics or?
Of course, yeah. No, definitely. You know, I was fortunate that, you know, from both a hip hop perspective and also a poetry perspective, it was, you know, it was gladiator school. And so, you know, one of the things that I really value that time, and I treasure that time as far as just developing my chops. Like, if you suck, there was people to show you that you suck. There was a real good mirror, like, oh man, this cat's killing it. Yeah, that were special, that were just amazing at their craft and that took it seriously and understood the cultural significance of it. That, you know, yeah, I went to Brooklyn Moon, you know, I went to New Eurekan, I went to Jimmy's Uptown, I went to Lyricist Lounge, you know, I was in a lot of spots and trying to at that point just develop those chops.
So that in the 90s, that was a pretty tough scene for the spoken word, especially in the 90s for the a lot of people were out there. Is that where you started really focusing in on your poetry in the 90s, like in the spoken word circuit or?
Yeah. You know, I was always a storyteller. I come from a long line of storytellers. You know, my whole family, that's what we do. There's a word that's also on the album right after he says, Iskutsik. It says, Atsuniki. Atsuniki means storyteller. And that's somebody who carries a message, and it's a responsibility, and it's also a privilege within my community. And I carry both of those. And so I've always done that. But from a performative standpoint, from a competitive standpoint, that's where I started to realize, okay, you have to actually be good at this. It's not enough just to do this, or it's important that you do this from a cultural standpoint. But you, I don't want to be the Indian poet or the Indian MC. I want to be the cat that chops people's heads off and happens to be Native, you know? And so that's where I got that instinct, was in that scene in the late 90s, early 2000s in New York's poetry and hip hop scene.
So who really influenced you when you first got to New York City on the portrait scene? Who would you see that was really like influential when you first got there that really blew you away?
Yeah, I mean, of course, you know, Saul Williams was just kind of winning at that time. You know, Saul was just amazing. There was a cat named Jamal St. Clair. Jamal was nasty. Ainsley Burroughs. Jessica Care Moore, because you know the sisters were doing it too. They were just right. Spitting nasty. And then on the hip hop front, you know, one of my favorite MCs are Ghostface, Melly Mel, KRS-One, and KRS-One at that time was still very prolific and still very active. And so it was cool to be able to see that in real time, just the confidence with which he approached his craft. You know, and so all of those folks really, really influenced both the delivery and also the audacity. Like, you know, KRS-One is an audacious dude. You know, he's just like, KRS-One is just the guy to lead a crew right up to your face and diss you, right? And so I realized that if you say something, there's people like Saul, although I loved Saul's wordsmithing and craftsmanship, I didn't want to necessarily people to get lost in the weeds of trying to decipher what I was saying. And so that's when I was kind of developing my style. And that's when I started to go with the storytelling, because I wanted you to get it. I don't want to speak over your head. I want you to know if I'm calling you a dirty, rotten scoundrel. I want you to know if I think you're a slime bag, or alternatively, I want you to know if I think you're beautiful. And so I thought that stories were the perfect conduit, both culturally, it reflected something that was indigenous to me as a native person, but also gave that hip hop influence, which was the conduit to tell the stories to a larger platform.
Nice. And you do it very well, because I want to get into this next joint, Jesus.
Oh man.
Yeah. And the way you say Jesus too. Like, I caught that. I was like, that was dope. You know what I'm saying? Because it's as if it was like the first time somebody heard that word. Yeah. And you try to pronounce it the way, you know what I'm saying, that you would say it. But yeah, I want to
I'm glad you caught that.
Right. I looked at this mad times. And we played joints on the show before. That's why I was excited to be able to have you on the show.
Yeah. Right. Thank you.
So I want to get into Jesus. It's featuring Martin Sensmeier on the flute, right? That was a beautiful flute playing also. That's really dope.
And just real quick, Martin Sensmeier, that's my little brother. He's a talented dude. But right now, you know, he actually got a huge win. He recently got cast. There's a remake of an old Western called The Magnificent Seven. And he got cast as the featured Indian dude, because you can't have more than one Indian dude. But he got cast as an Indian dude that's alongside Denzel Washington and Chris Pratt and Ethan Hawke. So it's a really, really big role for him. And it's his breakout role. So shout out to my little brother. I love that kid.
Wow, that's dope.
Nice. Real dope.
Yeah, isn't that Magnificent Seven? Is that based on the anime? Was it like an anime?
No, it wasn't.
No, there's an anime with seven. I think the anime is based on that. One of them.
I don't like you right now.
There's a correlation. Shut
just
up.
Making stuff up.
Whatever. No. So we're going to get into it, into the track, not into this fighting. But we're going to get into this joint. this is Jesus featuring Martin Sensmeier, Gyasi Ross.
Yes, sir.
Off the album.
Let's get it.
Exactly. That's out now. All right. Thank you for tuning in. It's our show. We'll be right back.
Dope.
And behind the scenes, I want to talk about Indian or Native American. Do you have a preference, or you know what I'm saying? So we'll talk about that while we play this show.
That sounds good.
All right. Thank you guys for tuning in. It's our show.
It's Kutsik.
Perfect. Good job.
All right.
Yeah, y'all.
All right.
Scootsick. Come on.
No, you gotta say the coots. You gotta put emphasis on that part.
I'm gonna put emphasis on you learning.
See, exactly. Scootsick.
Do it.
Scootsick.
It's Scootsick. Nice. Thank you guys for tuning in. It's our show. We'll be right back. This is Jesus by Gyasi Ross, our special guest right here. Thank you for tuning in. Be right back. Y'all be easy. Peace. Oh, by the way, instrumental in the background, this is A Tribe Called Red with their track Bread and Cheese featuring Black Bear. All right, y'all be easy. It's our show. Peace.
Oh, man, I wanted to get into that, actually.
Hold on. Give me a second. All right. So now, hey, have you heard of A Tribe Called Red?
Of course, yeah, yeah.
Crazy, right?
Yeah, they're doing it too. They're, you know, Big Brother Ernie Panicoli, he really gave them the education on the hip hop front. And are you familiar with Ernie Panicoli?
Nah, put me on.
He's a native brother that he grew up in New York in Brooklyn. And he's he had the book Who Shot You? Like, he's the photographer that was there for all the you know, Ground Zero.
Yeah,
hip-hop.
Early. Okay, yeah, okay. I know Who Shot You? Yeah.
And so he's the mentor to a lot of us, you know, younger hip hop cats that, you know, really are into the cultural component of it.
Oh, that's dope. Okay, so now, native as opposed to Indian, Native American as opposed to Indian or native, or what would you land on that?
You know, in Seattle and in the Seattle area, we say native a lot. And the reason why is because there's an official designation, like Alaska Native American Indian. And so you want to be inclusive of Alaska Natives as well. And so native kind of speaks to that. I like it a little bit more politically because it doesn't have the disclaimer, you know, of Native American. Because American, I don't consider myself American. You know, I voted for Barack because you got to vote for Barack. But, you know, I'm probably not going to vote in this next. Uncle Bernie Sanders, I might do, you know, Bernie Sanders, I might rock with him. But generally, I'm not messing with the United States. You know, and I don't. It's not a point of pride, and I don't like that to be part of the definition of who I am because we pre-existed the United States.
Exactly, because America came up around you.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Like,
exactly.
You were there. Like, my homeboy
on us,
right? Because my homeboy Matt Ills, he's Mexican, and he was saying how, like, they didn't jump the border jumped them.
Yeah, 100% true.
You know what I'm saying?
And it's been different places too. You know, that was that, and that's one of the things. I mean, ultimately, honestly, bro, I don't put a whole bunch of thought into it, but I understand people who do. You know, for me, I'm much more interested into the lower parts of Maslow's hierarchy. You know, I work with kids, and I, you know, like the kids that are at risk for suicide because it's a very, very real palsy and disease within our communities. Drug and alcohol abuse, heroin, pills, sex, you know, all those things. But that's not to say that we shouldn't focus on these things that are a little bit more philosophical. Those are very important. I have my thoughts on it. I use them both interchangeably, honestly. I use them interchangeably because I was influenced largely. The person that was speaking the Blackfoot language on the CD, that's my grandpa, Percy Bullchild. Mm-hmm. And I was raised a lot with my grandparents. Like I said, storytelling is something that comes down in my family. So because of that, that's what our immediate ancestors, grandparents and great grandparents, they said, whether it was right or wrong, they said Indian. And so because I was raised a lot by my grandparents, I say Indian a lot too.
Well, I know that. Yeah, it's the same thing with me because, you know, like Black folks. Well, my parents are Jamaican, so I'm first generation.
Okay.
Born, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And certain words like the N-word, and yeah. I never came up with that because it's not, right. It wasn't said. You know what I'm saying? So I just don't say it just because it was never really something I came up saying.
You know what That's
I mean? Right. It's kind of like I'm not for nor against it, really. I'd rather just deal with people.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, whereas it's, I see you as a human being. Let's build on that. I honestly don't care about that. I mean, I appreciate where you came from, but that doesn't define who you are to me now. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
You have a heritage, and that is awesome. But, I mean, because every race has an a-hole. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I'm the one for mine.
Yeah, some have quite a few.
Exactly. But you can't base that on where, like, their heritage is from. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's more like the experiences and things they choose. That's neither here nor there. That's just random things.
That's real.
Can you hear the music right now in the back?
You can't hear the music. You know what I'm saying? But this is another A Tribe Called Red.
So there's a group he's playing right now called A Tribe Called Red, and they remix a lot of their tribe's singing.
He knows about them.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I saw an interview. They went through it real quick. They couldn't go into major detail. They said they had to get basically permission from their elders, and they couldn't play all the songs because some of it's basically sacred. Or Is that you think that's tribe based or is that on?
Well, there's apps for a lot of our songs, a lot of our images even. There's a protocol in order to, because we believe in familial ownership of songs. And so it's not even necessarily a tribal thing. It's particular families, because you're talking about similar to the way Maoris do it, the way African griots do it. Mm-hmm. There's a lineage that's attached to that. And so if a particular lineage owns a, you know, they have it, this is their lineage. Well, you can't go give that to somebody else freely without having the permission to do that.
Right.
So it's
right,
just like, okay. it's like taking some a child's photograph, right? Like you're going to get permission from that person's parents first,
right,
before you go distribute, you know. And I'm a father, so I'm very, very sensitive to that. You know, like, nah, you got to, there's a protocol you got to respect.
Word, word. Yeah, because it was such a fast interview. They're just talking about their experiences and everything, and just went through that real quick. And I was like, oh, man, I wish they could have expanded on that a little bit, find out more.
Yeah.
Hey, anybody in the chat room say anything? Like, real quick, my bad.
Let me say,
like we have people in the chat room that we're totally ignoring right now. I'm sorry.
Chris says where he's at is only 600 miles away, so he definitely can't make it to the
Yeah, the homie Chris, I was telling you earlier in Alaska, he's like 600 miles away, he said, from you.
Oh, okay.
I never thought that Alaska is that vast.
Oh, man.
You know what I'm saying? Like I said,
Alaska is twice the size of Texas.
See, that's the thing. Like, I'm from Florida. Born and raised. That's amazing.
It's
damn
huge.
Yeah, dude.
Wow. And yeah, a lot of it is, like, unchartered, too, right? I mean, like, just
vast lands. But there's a lot of places, I think, that are, like, intentionally unchartered.
Yeah, exactly. Because
I don't really want to go there.
You legally can't buy land in some parts of Alaska. The government won't. Like, there's only a few people that were there from a long time ago. That's it. After they're dead, they can't. Their kids can't even grab it. So it's like, it's dangerous.
Yeah, that's tough. Yeah.
Right. There's a show that I like. It's called Life Below Zero. I don't watch a whole lot of television, but if you guys get a chance, watch it. And it talks about just how vast and how, you know, how much solitude certain parts have. Like there's this lady who lives way up there, Life Below Zero, way up near the Arctic, past the Arctic Circle, like 300 miles past the Arctic Circle.
Damn.
And she lives up there and she's by herself for literally hundreds of miles. I mean, there's nobody around her. And so she talks about how she survives on a daily basis. You know, she has to do all this stuff, but she chooses to be there. And it's a huge state.
Wow. That is amazing.
Maybe we could see Russia from here.
I don't even think she would really know it.
I'm sure she can.
All right, so anything else? Because I want to talk. I want to get more into like the lawyer thing. What? Why law? What?
Are you asking me now? Are we on there?
Yeah, we have. No, we've been on there. This is free form. This is okay. Just, you know, chilling. And I appreciate you for not cursing.
No doubt. The reason why law is a couple reasons. Number one, do we have a couple minutes?
Yeah, we have as much time as you want.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? We appreciate you talking to us.
Well, the most immediate reason was because, my family's broke, right? So, you know, it's a way to stabilize income. You can always get a job. It's like a glorified barbershop. You know, I know I could go get a job. Number two, I remember I was in Washington, D.C. I did this internship. And, like, this is the first time that I've been around, like, educated Indian people. I come from a very traditional family where, you know, and we kind of eschewed education. And I did this internship, like the fifth college I was at. And I knew I was going to college for some reason. I went to this internship in DC and I saw these fancy Indians there, you know, they got suits on and stuff like that. I got one blazer, one sport coat that I got from a thrift store. And it was like, you know, it's the early, or excuse me, late 90s. So like my shoulders are real big, everything's baggy. You know? And I go inside a reception, you know, where everybody's standing around with their suits, drinking drinks, and they got the name tags on. And I see this just gorgeous, gorgeous native girl. And she was just gorgeous. And so I go up to her and, you know, she's definitely looking flyer than me. She got the suit on and I see her name tag and it said, you know, university or whatever, law school. And so I did what any self-respecting Blackfeet, you know, native boy would do. And I lied to her. I was like, you know, I said, I said, I'm getting ready to go to law school too. You know, I'm applying right now, and maybe, you know, I get your email. We can, you know, connect, and you can, you know, help give me some pointers. And so, you know, like that worked out, and we ended up dating. And in fact, it worked out too well because we dated too long, and we went back to school. We went back to school, and now, like, oh man, she's gonna realize I'm a liar. So I like, I got to start applying to law school.
Oh man. I was only a liar
for like a month and a half because I actually started applying to law school.
So now, what exact like a field or like study, like what I don't know what they call it.
Specialty.
Specialty.
You know, I first of all, I barely practice law anymore. Now, fortunately, you know, I'm thankful. I'm very thankful. But, you know, between music, between writing and between teaching, that tends to be the majority of my income. And I'm very thankful for that opportunity. You know, it's not something I take for granted. But when I was practicing law as the focus of my time, I started off as a criminal defense lawyer, and I was really, really good. You know, I took it very seriously. I approached the smallest cases like they were capital murder trials, and, you know, really tried to give, because I come from a family that's been very badly compromised by the legal justice system. My pops was in and out. I have a lot of, you know, close relations that were in and out. And a lot of times you start to realize that justice is a 100% an economic thing, that the rich boys get different justice than the poor cats of any color. And so I wanted to give my clients a equal level of justice and opportunity to be heard as the rich boys got. And even though they couldn't afford it. And so that was what I was really committed to for a while. And then I had a son, I had a child, and, you know, as when children, you know, it gets expensive. So I had to make a little bit more money. And so I took a job, and it was primarily representing tribes in court, like federal, you know, like doing more civil stuff. But it was in different court settings as well.
All right. And what's dope now is, like, even though you moved beyond that, it's almost like you're trying to, with, like I said, with the mentoring that you're doing, the music, the books, the writing, the articles, the million things you do, it's almost like you're trying to, like, stop it before it gets to that point. You know what I'm saying? Through education beforehand.
Right.
Like, don't wait until you create and break the law.
Like, no, that's
exactly beforehand.
You know, all we see is, you know, I read this amazing book. It was called The Influencer. And it was talking about, you know, people sometimes, my son, he likes basketball. And it's easy, really easy to tell him to go out and be a good basketball player. But it's much harder, and it takes much more focus to say, well, what does that mean? Tell me the behaviors. Don't focus on outcomes. Focus on behaviors. It's easy to say, well, I want to be in the NBA. But what does that mean? Well, you have to shoot 1,000 jump shots a day. You have to do X, Y, and Z. And so now I consider myself as focusing more on behaviors. How do we create healthy behaviors within our communities? And that means everything from taking our own accountability, because one of the things that we do, and I think that this is, you know, something that makes sense given history, you know, that we oftentimes say, well, you know, other folks have done this, you know, they've done something to us, and we put ourselves as the object in a particular sentence. And that's important. Yeah. What's that?
As a victim, basically.
Yeah, like, that's what it
is, because.
And sometimes all it is historically correct. All you're doing is acknowledging history. But at the same time, I truly believe that we still have a place where we have to be just more accountable and say, okay, we understand that there are structural impediments and obstacles to doing whatever, but let's assume that those will always be there. What are we gonna do anyway, in spite of that? And so, you know, that's something that I've tried to do, is outside of judgment, outside of, you know, really, really trying to point fingers any place, how do we just, as a you know, discipline, take the time to find ways to overcome obstacles through behaviors, through changing behaviors. And that's exactly, I appreciate that perspective, because that's exactly what I've tried to do, is to focus more on proactively creating stuff and creating people that, you know, within our communities that are healthier. You know, I think it was Frederick Douglass said that it's easier to raise healthy children than to fix broken men.
Mm. Damn,
you know, trying to do it after the fact is tough.
Definitely. Hey, real quick, shout out to Favor 1682 in the chat room. He said the Western is loosely based off the Seven Samurai movie. Ah,
hold on. The movie, not anime.
Whatever,
bruh.
Whatever. Anyway. That was anime based off of that. All I knew it came from.
Whatever, man. Whatever.
Damn. I was right. It's based off something. No. Whatever. No. All right.
Yaddy, yaddy, yaddy. Okay, so I got a really quick question for you. You went to school in New York, and I did read at some point that you were doing you were writing for some hip hop publications. Is that correct?
Well, kind of.
Okay.
What's kind of mean?
God bless the dead. One of my best friends in the world. His name was Rashawn Hilson. He passed last year, January 2nd, 2014, 37 years old, had a massive heart attack, very healthy young man. He had a hole in his heart, but the reason why I bring him up is because when I first moved to New York, on the album, there's Abiodun Oyewole from The Last Poets in there. Mm. And he's Abiodun Oyewole's, his nephew. And he introduced me to Abiodun, but we all played ball. And so Rashawn, he got me involved. We were playing ball and he was like, Gyasi, you're struggling a little bit economically. So I got some magazines that you could write for. It's a real good hustle. And so he was writing for The Source. And so, The Source at that time, 99, 2000 was the joint. Like that was huge.
The Bible.
And so we got invited all the
It was the Bible.
Yeah, that was the one. But, they weren't going to just take me as a newcomer to go write for The Source. So I honestly got all the kind of, lower rate, the Source subsidiaries. And like I ended up writing for some like skin mags and stuff like that, trying to do intellectual stuff in girly magazines and stuff. So kind of hip hop ish, a lot of baby oil, a lot of, Nelly videos and stuff like that. Well, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt this question, though. There was a question coming.
Cool. Go ahead. Now, what was the rest of the question?
My the question I wanted to ask you is being in that environment, and being native. Did you ever receive any kind of resistance to working in hip hop? Like, I've come across where I'm Filipino American, and being in hip hop, I grew up in Jacksonville, which wasn't too used to seeing, Asian Americans or Filipino Americans being interested in hip hop. Yeah. Did you meet any of that kind of resistance, from that circle of the people in New York when you were, going to school and writing for the publications?
I don't know if I did it. I didn't never got it explicitly. I never got it as a thing where, honestly, I think that there's times where I've been precluded for opportunities as a result I've considered that as a factor because of, this doesn't really fit, I don't understand the hip hop native, I think that there's been times where that's been a consideration in things where I felt like I was perfectly qualified and maybe more qualified than other individuals to do, but I've never gotten it very explicitly. I can't think of any instance where I got it, where I can say, I could just put my finger on it. Mm-hmm. But I could say that I suspect it's happened in different situations. And that usually manifested itself by virtue of not getting opportunities.
Mm. All right, word up. So anybody else got anything to say? Because, you're right now you're in Alaska. You travel a lot, you know what I'm saying? So now you're in Alaska for what? There's a music fest going on?
Yeah, it's called Home Skillet Fest. And it's a really cool music festival. A lot, it's a lot of West Coast artists, a lot of Canadian here. The hip hop contingent this year, there's a guy named Jarve D. In the past, there's been Shabazz Palaces, Macklemore has come up here. I mean, it's not a huge festival because it's in Sitka, Alaska. It's not a big place. But it's a really cool one because you have when you do come up here, you understand the imprint, the footprint that it leaves upon the place, and that's really cool. Next week, I'll be going out to Minneapolis. You had to mention my traveling. I'll be going out to Minneapolis to work with a couple of tribes out there and hopefully hook. You saw I had Slug from Atmosphere on the album.
That's one of the first joints we played off his joint, yeah.
Yeah, Slug, he's a special dude, and, you know, he's very near and dear to my heart, and hopefully I'll be able to connect with him. You know, Prince was my first hero, so I always look forward to going to Minneapolis. You know, I stopped by First Avenue because you have to. Got to. And then I'll be
in the waters of Lake Minnetonka.
No, I got it. I stripped down. I strip down every time I go out there. So, everybody wants some cheap entertainment. You know, let's go out to Lake Minnetonka. I'll be in Austin, Texas after that. We're looking at Cabin Games Records. My manager Brody Stevens, like we're looking at a very curated tour. You know, I don't, just because of, you know, being a father, I take that very seriously, and it's something that is, I wasn't raised around my father that much because I said he was in and out, and so I try to be there for my son more often than not, and we're gonna put together a very curated tour where we're going to, you know, strategic places, and hopefully really this album, performing the album and performing in a way that gives a lot of resonance, because we're going to do visuals. There's a lot of visuals involved with it because it's a very visual album. It's storytelling.
Yeah, definitely.
And just like you said, and I really appreciate, that's the biggest compliment you can give, that you said that you felt like you were there. I want to bring people to the experiences. I want to bring people there to feel what it felt like to be a, you know, 9-year-old kid that was being ostensibly bullied by, you know, for racial reasons that you didn't even understand, that you have no reason to have any context for, but you know that is there, and you have, you know, you're in this economically vulnerable place, you're in a physically vulnerable place because you're a little kid amongst white adults and stuff, and I you know, just all those stories, I want to kind of bring them to life on the stage, and we're putting that together now.
No. Well, if you're ever, like, you know, in the Orlando, Florida area, let us know, and I'll definitely make sure that we get the word out. Whatever I need to do to drag people or whatever.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. And we will make it down, too.
Nice. Anybody else got anything to say real quick? Or
I'm good.
Okay, cool.
Drop it on a good note.
Question. Are you working on a third book, or what we got going?
A few things. I have a book in my head that's, I mean, and I mean that, like, usually it's a matter of when I don't want to sleep, because once I start writing, I'm just not going to sleep, you know, and that, you know, and so do I really want to do that to myself right now? It's really physically a rough process because I'm going to get fat, morbidly obese, and, you know, like eating bad and stuff, just sitting in front of my computer for that period of time. But we are going to have, first of all, we have a video out right now for the song Harvard.
Yes.
It's gotten a really cool response. It was, thank you to allhiphop.com, debuted the song, the video. OK Player picked it up. And then there's a whole bunch, I mean, Hip Hop Hill Headquarters, like there's a whole bunch of websites that showed a lot of love. And thank you to my publicist, Dove Clark, that, you know, really, really has been pushing it and has been believing in the project. You know, Cabin Games Records, K Records, Calvin Johnson. I mean, they've been just beautiful in regards to the, you know, and you know this, I mean, and I'm fine with talking about this, by the way, that it's a square peg in a round hole. You know, the project is not an easily defined project. And so we weren't sure if it was going to sell one copy or if it was going to sell a million, because it's something, I think, that we created a format. We created a template with this that, you know, previously, poetry artists, they didn't really, you know, they like, how do we create something that plays well in a ride, in a whip?
Yeah.
And that was my test with this. It has to play in a car. Otherwise, I'm doing this just as a vanity project. And there's amazingly, amazingly powerful and talented poets who haven't been given that opportunity because they didn't have the bright musical accompaniment around them. And for me, it wasn't me that created that. There's a young man, his name is Chell Nelson, who did the production on most of the album. And the other song with Abiodun Oyewole, Steve Fisk, he did the production on that. And they created that. They created the listening experience that allowed it to to be able to just go from one song to the next. And for you as the listener to say, okay, I can dig this. You know, otherwise there's one voice that's droning. And no matter how compelling the stories are, they get old after a little while. You know, the voice gets old. And I'm perfectly cognizant of that. I'm cool with that. And so I'm just thankful for them, taking the, you know, taking the time to really develop that template. How can you do this in a way that doesn't compromise the message, doesn't compromise the value of these incredible stories? Because they are incredible stories, but at the same time, makes it so that it's palatable over a long period of time. And I think we accomplished that.
Yes, definitely did. Because it, like I said, every time I listen to it, I always catch something new. You know what I'm saying? And it's really dope.
Yep.
And like you said, music, like, it eases in any sort of messages that you want to put into it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because even especially now, with the stuff mm-hmm. that's played everywhere,
yep.
people are all like, yeah, that's a dope beat. I have no really clue what he's saying.
No clue. Lifestyle. Like, I know one word of that song. You know
what I'm saying? I don't even know what song that is. I don't listen to
it. All I'm saying is I don't understand when it was – I don't get when it was cool to spit on a song and act like you got a speech impediment. It just doesn't make sense to me. Dude.
Yeah. Well, you know. Let me back up, because I there's a part of me that I agree with you 100%, my brother. I agree, and I think that there's absolutely a need. You know, there's a song by Goody Mob, and the hook says, "We're fighting for our spirits and minds," and I really think that battle's happening. And I think that there's a compelling interest in having a generation of 300 million Americans and hopefully 7 billion people across the world that are just brainless consumers that don't pay attention to what they listen to what they buy, what they put in their body, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that there really is a battle going on a much bigger level, on a Rupert Murdoch, you know, Koch brothers level. And I think that's happening. However, I think there is also a place for that idiotic, stupid, nonsensical drivel like Young Thug that, you know, that nobody can say. And the reason why I say that is because of history. Because I don't listen to Young Thug, but I have an 8-year-old son and I have a 17-year-old nephew. And so I hear that stuff and I'm like, this is stupid. You know, it sounds like he's gargling. But I also understand that I think that there's a historical precedent with, for example, scatting, where people, you know, where people weren't necessarily making sense. It was like they were trying to catch the emotion, but not necessarily the intellect. And they were trying, maybe I'm giving them way too much credit because
I'm sure he probably has no clue, but I agree with you. Whereas if they're primarily using the voice as another instrument.
That's right. Yes.
You know what I'm saying? So not necessarily, because they're just like, this beat instrumental has a feeling. Yeah. And not to take away from it, I'm just going to kind of add to it, sort of. You
know what yeah. I'm
saying? So, but I mean, and I feel you, there needs to be a balance. I can't say what's right, what's wrong, but the balance is not there.
Not at all.
You know what I'm saying? The 90s, you had, people forget that the 90s had all type of stuff. You know what I'm saying? They think fondly back in those days, but there was, the stuff people are talking about now may not be as bad, might have been higher quality, but it was still going on back then.
No, of course. Right.
But the fact that we had, like, the P.E.s, we had De La Soul, we had Tribe.
I can understand Eazy-E saying, cruising down the street in my 6'4".
Yeah, I feel you. Yes.
All right.
But that's what I'm saying. But there was a balance. It's a balance.
Well, and you had, there was people who, you know, I mean, to get really, really deep, you had deregulation in 1996, right? You have Clear Channel that, you know, was able yep. to occupy so many spaces within a particular market. I mean, just to keep it funky, that's what happened. And so at that point, it became competition that you had no real meaningful decision. You had a decision amongst 40 particular songs. And within that, you forgot the whole universe. Before that, there was one of my favorite albums in the early 90s was MC Brains. I mean, it was a Oochie Coochie Lala, right? But you also, at that same time, on that same top 10 chart, you also had Arrested Development with Tennessee. You also had Mr. Wendell. You had Everyday People. You know, you had people that were making great music, and as you said earlier, containing that message within there, and it was really, really dope. And now I don't even think there's an opportunity to do that. I think there's actually an antithetical approach and response when somebody like, nah, don't, you know, like on Menace to Society, would you try to kick knowledge? You know, like people take offense to that.
You trying to teach me? What is this?
The thing with it though, like now, I think the only, I mean, for me, the only example of that being played on the airwaves is an artist like a Kendrick Lamar.
Yes.
You can have King Kunta playing on the radio and have spins running all the time and being able to have a different message than what everybody else is saying. And I think that that's dope because it puts him in a position where, yeah, obviously he's in his own lane. He's got his own music and his own style. But because he's actually saying something, is differentiating him from everybody else that's out there in you know, that top 40 market.
And I feel you. I get that. But sometimes I wonder if the message is really getting there because Swimming Pools, and that song, right. Like in the club, people think it's like a drinking song. But it's like so every exactly. Every time he says drank, people are like, and I mean, that is so not the message of the
trip. It's
going to be difficult to reach just some people. And I believe like in evolution, some people aren't really made to make it. You can't save everybody. Right.
That's true.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? So the people who are down to roll, let's go. Other people, meh, whatever. I'll catch you.
Well, and that's one of
the bears running after them.
Yeah. That's one of the things that's interesting about music is, you know, and especially hip hop, is because the reason why I got into hip hop from a fan standpoint was because it was an evolutionary message. You know, it was Melly Mel saying, you know, a teacher can express 1,000 words. You know, like there was a message behind it. And you think through the years, you know, 1989 is a number, another summer. Like there was constantly a survival component to it, telling you, you know, that you have to be aware of certain things, telling you that, you know, be aware of the media, right? She watched Channel Zero. There was all these things that were, and then like now I listen to music and I listen to somebody like Future, or I listen to some, you know, that are telling you all these very creative ways for primarily young black men, primarily young black women to kill themselves, because that's what it amounts to. And it becomes an anti-evolutionary thing. Like, no, you're really, really, you know, telling, I got into one of my friends, you know, who's an artist. I'm not going to say his name, but it, you know, he, after the Sandra Bland thing, he posted some stuff about, like, you know, going out and killing cops. And like I understand the thought, I understand the emotion, because in that moment you're vulnerable, you're mad, you know, there's that anger comes from a very, very honest place. However, when you say that, you are almost literally saying go kill yourself, because if you as a young black man or a young black woman or a young person of color or anybody really goes and kills a cop or shoots at a cop, you're gonna get killed. And so from that position of privilege, telling somebody else to go do that self-destructive behavior, well, you're not taking that risk yourself. That's anti-evolutionary. You're telling people that you don't value their life.
Exactly. Exactly. Damn. All right. So we've taken like an hour of your time, and I appreciate it.
Your time. I appreciate it, bro.
Hey, this is what we do. Like, it's about, like I said, bring balance. It's hip hop for people that know better. You know what I'm saying? That's what we do here. And we really appreciate you be able to kind of come on and talk about that. What else is coming up? Because you write for a bunch of different magazines and online sources. Anything else coming along with that? Or?
Yeah, no, of course. I mean, you know, there's once again, we have a video. I'm in Alaska, but we were just shooting a video, because this video is not going to have me, because I'm tired of seeing myself in the video. So we shot a video today. Down in on the Suquamish Indian Reservation, and it's gonna be dope. It's gonna be really, really hot. Moreover, we're me and one of my label mates / old friends, my buddies. His name is Silas Black. He has an album coming out, and it's a banger. It's a banger, Silas Black. Crazy. You need to check it out. I mean, it's definitely intelligent person music, and sometimes he's like dumb smart. You know, like he's so smart that like, come on, man, just stop. Stop! Don't
like Jizza from Wu-Tang.
Yeah, oh man, it's incredible! It's incredible, and his album is gonna be a classic. And so that'll be coming out pretty soon. But we're gonna do a joint project that's really, really going to dig very deeply into a lot of the history. You know, because this is gonna be storytelling still, and it's gonna dig. I'm fascinated by the story, especially down in your area, how a lot of the slaves escaped through using, you know, through Native communities. And how, you know, the swamps, right? the Great Dismal Swamp, the swamps down there, that became a place of refuge. And so we're actually doing a project that's really, really ambitious, and it might end up sucking because it's so ambitious, but we're aiming for the stars and we think it's going to come out gold.
Nice. Because that resonates with me because, like I said, my folks are Jamaican.
Yeah. But
like my people, like the maroon slaves.
The maroon, so yeah.
Once they hit that beach, they're gone.
Exactly.
They went into the woods, and I mean, and it was the native people there that kind of took them in and taught them how to survive, pretty much. You know what I'm saying? And right. So that sounds dope.
Yeah. No, it's gonna be powerful. And we also, you know, I'm doing some pieces because at the same time, you know, I did want to slow my friend's roll regarding, you know, the police bit, you know, of violence against police. Yeah. But there is something that's really happening right now. And you and I know, and everybody knows here, that it's been happening for a lot of years. It's just now we have the benefits of cameras on, you know, body cams and camera phones. And, you know, unfortunately, it takes that sort of level of proof for white people, essentially, to believe that it actually happens to us. Walter Scott's happened 1,000 times before. But, exactly. You know, but it just happened to have me on video. And it's sort of like, you know, with the Donald Sterling thing last year with the Los Angeles Clippers, people, Elgin Baylor had been saying that Donald Sterling was a racist for 30 years, but now you got him on tape. Oh, I guess you guys were right. And so, you know, we just need to document these things. We need to be storytellers. We all have to be storytellers. We have a duty. Otherwise, these stories get lost. And it's important, especially during this time of vulnerability and this interaction that with police officers that's really, really tense and really, really tumultuous, that we have to be able to tell our story. And that story is that, you know, not all of us are dedicated. In fact, most of us aren't dedicated. We don't want further violence. We want the violence to stop for everybody.
Yes.
You know, and so I don't want you to get shot, but I don't want me to get shot either. I don't want my son to get shot. And so we need to, you know, at this time, really voice that even more so. And I think come out of a position of love. And we're creating a project that's surrounded with that sort of interaction that hopefully has a level of honesty, but at the same time comes from a point of love. You know, I have no problem with telling exactly the truth about that historical relationship, just like KRS talked about, you know, overseer, you know, like it came from the particular place, but we can still say that with love because we have to evolve together. Look, we're stuck with each other. We're not going anyplace. You're not going anyplace. Let's figure this out.
Exactly. And
have you ever thought about expanding like a stage show of your stories? I seen a video of a guy named Ariel Lucky. Have you ever heard of Ariel Lucky?
I have not. I'm gonna look him up though.
He has a story. Gosh, I can't remember. It's basically he mixes hip hop in with a story about his white privilege and owning land, basically. Okay. His family owning land. It's called it was called Free Land, and how his perspective on man, you would take off in that media, man. Just from hearing your album. I think I would come to see that show. So I'm just you know, mixing the two, and it would sound really good.
No, I'm gonna check out Ariel Lucky right now. I did a little Google search right now. I'm gonna do some research.
There's a great. He has like a DJ tells his whole story on his family and learning about expanding on about like learning roads, like name of roads in Oklahoma and stuff like that. So
that's dope.
Knowing the actual name. We have a county here called Osceola County.
Yep.
And so that whole story on that, it's too, anyway, I'm rambling. Anyway.
All right. So, let's end it off with another joke. Okay. So, once again, for the folks tuned in, WPRK, Winter Park, Florida, 91.5 FM, we got Gyasi Ross in with us right now. Just dropping. Man, this is awesome. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Again, this is great. You.
The name of the album again, sir?
You going to put me on the spot?
Yes, I am.
It's Skutsik.
Hey! You got it! Yes!
It took an hour!
Yeah.
If you want to find out more information about Gyasi Ross, it's GYASI-ROSS.com.
Don't go breaking your arm, patting yourself on the back.
I do all right. I'm double jointed. It's cool.
Gross.
All right.
thank y'all very much. I've had a blessed time, and I really appreciate you folks for spreading knowledge, you know, giving that balance. And thank you very much. And thank you for everybody who's listened, who's supported. The albums are doing very well. It's top 10. It was top 10 in college radio hip hop charts for a while. And it's a different experience, and I think that you'll truly appreciate it. Thank you to my label, Cabin Games, K Records for the distribution. I love all y'all. Thank you.
Well, shout out to our co-sign collective, the radio promoters who hooked this up, and I appreciate that. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely, co-sign.
Mm-hmm. All right. So you want to get into one more joint, and so we can.
Yeah.
Right? Sure. What do you want to get into?
I think you know one of my favorite songs. I think it's a very very compelling song. Is the song we talked about, a Slug from Atmosphere, and the song is called No Assistance, with assistance from Richie Daggers Crime singing. He has an amazing voice, an angelic voice, and I think it's a very special record. Peace and love to all the families that have been affected by suicide of any ethnicity, because it's an increasing, as an empirical thing, it's an increasing phenomenon within this country, and we need to figure out what's going on with our kids.
Word. All right, give me one random fact about it, and we'll get right into it.
About No Assistance?
Yeah, it could be about the writing, the production, the recording, whatever.
You know, that particular song, Slug was very, very generous. He was on vacation in Mexico. and I told him, like, we our distribution date, we had our distributor, K Records, they had to have it in by X date. I don't remember what it was now. But, I mean, that man, he hustled. He was someplace in Mexico, and somehow he found a studio in Mexico and knocked it out. And so much love to Slug for knocking that out, you know, against the deadline, and came through like a champ. His verse is amazing. And Richie Daggers Crime, he's got an album coming out at the top of next year, and he's got a special voice.
Dope. So yeah, so please don't let this be the last time, you know what I'm saying, that we have you on the show. Anytime, anything you want to talk about, let me know, and we'll definitely get you on.
Thank you very much, brother. I appreciate all you folks. Thank you so much. I really enjoyed the conversation. I talk too much. Next time I'll listen more, but I really appreciate your
this
time.
This is awesome. Like, this is what people hear us talk all the damn time.
Yeah, they're tired, you know what I'm saying?
We want to hear somebody else. So, word. Right.
Thank you very much. I plan on taking you up on that offer, bro.
Sounds great. All right, fam. Thank you again. And Gyasi, GYASI-ROSS.com. For everything that he's a writer,
author,
like, well, author and writer, that'd be the same thing. Sorry. Thanks. Throw me off.
Lawyer,
spoken word artist, and most importantly, father, and just a great human being altogether.
And a bather in Lake Minnetonka.
In Lake Minnetonka. That's what I'm talking about.
Nice. Well, thank you, fam. Again, this is going to be on YouTube real soon, this whole video and everything. Yeah. And this is going to be awesome. The recording of the show is going to be up at itsourshow.net. And yeah, like, I'm going to have links to everything that we talked about. And yeah, hopefully you just spread this knowledge. Thank you very much, man.
Thank
you
so much. All right,
easy.
Peace.
All right, word up. That was awesome. Nice.
Yes.
I told y'all it was going to be awesome.
Yes. Dang, you the truth.
Dang. Eh, I do all right. All right.